Dear colleagues, dear students, for all, thank you very much for your invitation to this workshop. You see a nice picture of the Earth in high definition, real impression. Here's Australia for orientation. And thank you very much for your patience with us in coming with the joint degree master's program. We worked together since 2012, beginning of 2012, the first discussions. So I hope end of this year we finally start the program. I hope so. So I think the workshop maybe could be the final lunch of the master's program. And the topic of my first lecture is not about building or sustainability in the narrow sense. My lecture is more about the big framing of sustainability in Germany or in a global way of sustainability. But the effects on cities, on urban structures, on buildings are quite clear in my opinion. So I call it metamorphosis. It's a difficult word. It's not from me alone. I explain you. And how climate change might save the world in a bigger framing. So let's start. The word metamorphosis is not from me, it's from a book from Ulrich Beck in a sociologically definition of metamorphosis, not in a building design sense, but we could translate them to a bigger framing. The question behind that definition is what is the meaning of the global events that we see on television? Terrorism, floods, droughts. We cannot understand this impact on our life. So we live in a world that is increasingly difficult to understand much more. We cannot conceptualize the terms in notations of change, evolution, revolution, or transformation. It's more than this. So we can use this to understand the world better and maybe the urban design or building design. Change implies some things change, other things remain the same, like capitalism, some things change, many things stays the same. What we accept is much more than this, a radical transformation with all things, certainties of modern society are falling away and something quite new is emerging. For example, the Chinese case, transformation means that China experienced since the Cultural Revolution and the Chinese economic reform an evolutionary path from closed to open, from national to global, from poor to rich, from isolated to more involved. But metamorphosis is much more than this. It means something different from evolutionary path, from closed to open. It means epochal change of worldviews and global meaning. So how can we grasp this? It's not caused by war, violence, or imperial aggressions, for my opinion, but it's caused by the side effects of successful modernization or such digitalization or, for example, the anticipation of climate catastrophe to humankind. It's a much more bigger framing of all. So you have learned German, I think. So you learned maybe a new word, Weltbild, world picture, yeah, in a philosopher meaning of the word Weltbild. So the traditional, institutionalized, national, international Weltbild, the world picture, is significant in how humans today apprehend the world as withered. The fixed stars are not fixed anymore. To understand this, it's important why the world picture of sun, planets, etc. is historically fails. You can make pictures, but I record this presentation and give you and send you all via YouTube or anything else. So you can make pictures maybe, but quality is much better if I send you the presentation. To understand why the world picture is historically fails, we need to distinguish between the Copernican term in the natural scientific and social scientific sense. The world picture was claimed that the sun is turning around the earth has always been fails. But it is only that this reality has been denied by those following and defending the religious dogma. It's always been fails. In a similar manner to how the modern international world order to sovereign states, industrialization, capital classes, nations, and democracy sets in and unfolded after the collapse of religious world order. After that, global climate risk contains, for my opinion, a sort of navigation system for the threatened world. You can find denotes in the, or climate risk denotes the path throughout this difficulties. So, but this not means that will be ever a successful path. It could be, it's possible that humanity may choose a path at the end of which lies its self-destruction. Maybe. It's not sure. You see it later in a later chart. What's the reason for this argumentation or thesis? People who have never left their villages, let alone ever boarded a plane, are still closely and commonly linked with the world now. In one way or other, they are affected by global risks. One reason, and they are interlinked with the world, not least because the mobile phone has become to be an integral part of the everyday across the global. You see it at yourself. Everyone has a mobile. Everyone. Near 100%. But it is not simply that everyone is interlinked, but then is entering into world means to enter something that follows a completely different logic. They end up in a world that is fundamentally different from what they think and expect, a world which they are metamorphosed into. Data resources, you all are data resources, and transparent and controllable consumers for global transnational companies or corporations. And this is a key figure of this changing, this metamorphosis. If you see only the food companies, the global food companies and the structure, you can recognize this. What are the impacts? So, that's normal with the sound. I hope you understand something. We will see.
Will the strongest El Nino in almost 20 years mean relief for drought-stricken California? Should New England brace for another snowy winter? NOAA's Winter Outlook, issued on October 15th, offers a look at what's most likely to occur.
That's the United States. Climate forecast for winter 15-16.
After flirting with El Nino last winter, the atmosphere finally began responding to the warming ocean last spring. Since then, sea surface temperature departures have steadily increased. And heading into winter, we are seeing values not seen since the big 1997-98 episode. Strong El Ninos are known to exert a significant influence on our weather and climate, particularly during winter. So not surprisingly, the outlooks this year reflect El Nino impacts. Above average temperatures are favored across much of the west and the northern half of the contiguous United States. Temperatures are also favored to be above average in Alaska and much of Hawaii. Below average temperatures are most likely in the southern plains and in the southeast.
So you can watch the full video on YouTube, but the important message is not El Niño or this year is a stronger winter or a warmer winter. It's the impact for the USA. Yeah? So to put it differently, those who take the national imperative as the imperative for their action, who stop at national borders, I think will be the losers of the cosmopolitized world. It's one phase for the national imperative at this time, I think. And it's day for another schizophrenic view of the world, you see, two, three charts later. So this is the end of cosmopolitan idealism and the beginning of the cosmopolitan realism of successful action for humankind. It's a bigger framing. So my thesis is you have to open up for the world if you want to succeed. All life, it's a regional definition of success. But how climate change might save the world now? Today, most discussions on climate change are blocked. As you see in Paris at the end of 2050, it's a great contract between 200 states and countries about the climate change. We see a little bit later. But the discussion is blocked. They are caught by catastrophism circulating on the horizon of the problem. What is climate change bad for? But from a point of view of metamorphosis, because climate change has a threat to humankind, we can and should turn the question upside down, and we have to ask, what is climate change good for us? It's a difficult question, and it's not clear. So you have to recognize that climate change is the embodiment of the mistakes of a whole epoch of ongoing industrialization, and climate risk pursue their acknowledgments and corrections with all the violence of the possibility of annihilation. And we have to distinguish two framings. We have a basic framing, the first framing, who ask a normative and political question, what can we do against climate change? That's the first question. Sustainable buildings, sustainable cities, renewable energies. It's answers, puzzle pieces of puzzle to answer the first question. But the second framing is a more sociologically and analytical question. What does climate change do to us? And how does it alter the order of society and politics? And it have consequences for urban design, for my opinion, in a bigger framing, I think. So what we see is, under the stress of finding workable solutions, the first question, what can we do against climate change, tends to dominate the second question, what is climate change good for us and do with us? And this is one important reason why, at the present moment, our collective powers of social and political imagination seem blocked. We have a contract of Paris. We see the big points of this contract later. But we have no national law who implies the big points in national regulations at this moment. And on the other side, never before in our history, and it's an important point, a crucial point, never before in our history has political life been saturated by this much knowledge about impending global emergency. Never before. We see the way. Yeah? Not all, but many of the people. So climate change alters society in fundamental ways, entailing new forms of power, inequality, and insecurity, as well as new forms of cooperation certainties and solidarity across borders. And for example, three effects illustrate this interpretation. First effect, you know, rising sea levels. They are creating changing landscapes. We see an example of this in the next chart. Changing landscapes of inequality, drawing new world maps whose key lines are not traditional boundaries between nation states and social classes, but elevations above sea or river. This is the one picture on the last climate research from the UN. And you see the rising in different models between, I think, 13 centimeters to 1 meter. So what are the effects? You see the region of Hong Kong. This is Hong Kong. This is the Chinese region with Jiangsu, Duanguan. And if the sea level rises about 1 meter, these areas are flooded in China. And 50 million people have to move only in this region. Only in this region. And 10% of mankind have to move if the sea level rises about 1 meter. No one in Jordan, maybe in Aqaba, could be. But it is a global problem. So we have USA, El Nino, we have China. Effects of climate changing in China. 10% of mankind over the world. Next video, I send you later. I have enough time. So second example, changing climate produces a basic sense of ethical and existential violation that creates new norms, laws, markets, technologies, understandings of the nation and the state. Urban forms, new urban forms are creating, and international cooperation. And third, the cosmopolitan turns is unfolding not in the thinking about the world and the withering of national doctrines, but firstly and mainly in the reality of everyday practices and activities. It's also new. And the insight that no nation state can cope alone with the global risk of climate change has become common sense this year. So we have another big country in the world. You understand German, so I have a video from the German television, Tagesschau.
Der Boden verkarstet, die meisten Brunnen versiegt, Lastwagen mit Wassertanks fahren unter Polizeischutz. Eine schwere Dürre hat derzeit Teile in Griff. Betroffen sind nach Schätzung der Regierung 330 million
people alone in India. It's not so important, the text, the information, only the pictures. So a big country, a developing country, India, one third is affected by the drought in India, the strongest drought for 100 years.
Maharashtra gebracht werden muss. Ein Ende der Trockenheit ist nicht abzusehen.
Temperaturen erreichen in vielen Gegenden zurzeit Rekordwerte. Und dieses Jahr soll das heißeste in der Geschichte Indiens werden.
So, what you see here is another problem for us to do things against climate change, because we have to make a fundamental distinction between those who generate risk, maybe USA or Europe, and those who are affected by it. India, for example, it's a developing country. So, in case of climate change, these groups are completely different. It's also different, these groups who are decision-making and decision-makers. We can also differentiate between these groups. So, remember the chart with the USA next president, maybe. Given the reality of cosmopolitization, the rebirth of the national outlook is paradoxical. It's paradoxical. It characterizes the schizophrenic structure of the, another German word, Zeitgeist. Time mind, yeah, Zeitgeist. And it is the national outlook in public and academic. You see also in Poland, you see also in Germany, you see also in European Union at the moment. But the national outlook in the moment and the academic discourse that blinds us to alternatives for the climate change action that we see from a point of view of cosmopolitan point of view. The national borders limited us. So, the first changing you see in industry, for example. Transnational companies, such as Coca-Cola, have always been focused more on their economic bottom than on global warming. But when the company losses lucrative operating license, for example in India, because of the serious water shortage, the perceptions and priorities begin to change at these companies. And you see, it's a global network of companies. Their position is at striking odds with the long-standing argument advanced by economics and managers of transnational companies that policies to cap carbon emission are more economically harmful than the impact of climate change itself. And they change their point of view. So, the new power structure is emerging, from my opinion. It is composed of urban professionals in world cities, urban transnational classes with varying historical backgrounds, not nation states. Urbanization used to be defined in opposition to nature. Nowadays, it is the other way around. Green urbanism is everywhere, you see. Sustainability, whatever it is, it's a difficult word, has become normalized. Everything is now about greening, you see. Not nation states, in cities. Yeah, for example, yeah. Yeah. But now the big question, but are we sure? Is it man-made climate change? Or is it weather? It's random.
It's Mother Nature.
No? It's Mother Nature. Yeah, it's up and down. Yeah, it's a specticism.
Taking advantage from human mind.
Yeah. 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 So, what can be the counter-argument if you ask this question? So, we are a little bit different from the official opinion, I think, but we can answer with the philosopher Blaise Pascal, the French philosopher, and his pragmatic proof of God. I don't know if you know this proof of God. Pascal argued that either God exists or he doesn't. yeah, to climate change random or is it man-made? And his simple answer can give us another point of view, maybe. He answers, I don't know, he said, but I have to choose God because if God exists, I win. If he doesn't, I don't lose anything. So if we create a new point of view on climate changing and we make more sustainable resources or renewable energies into houses, new urban structures, we can lose everything, but we can only win. So it does not matter. We have to find answers about three question framings. Time, who starts? It's a simple question, but a very difficult question. Individual, nation, cities, European Union. And a big problem is success of action is much more later than your life. Yeah, you died before you see the effect of your activities. It's a problem. Yeah? And the motivation of this. The second framing is about the goals. What is sustainability? We can discuss 1 year, 2 years about the definition of sustainability. Then individual goals versus national goals versus global goals. It could be very different for India and for us. India, developing country, German is not a developed country. We have other goals. And who generate risk versus who are affected by it. And the third framing, I think, is trust. How can we control? Who can control? Who pay for it? It's a simple question, also a difficult question. So what can be the answer for this? What can be a motivation for changing? Let's have a short look about of the resources of the world, a few fossil resources, oil, gas, and coal. So, policymakers have generally agreed that the average global temperature rise caused by greenhouse gases emissions should not exceed 2 degrees Celsius. 1.5 would be better, they say in Paris, but 2 degrees is the limit. So then, we have at least only a 50% chance to reach the goal. And we have to limit the carbon dioxide emissions around to 1,100 gigatons between 2011 and 2050. What we see in the present estimates of global fossil fuels reserves are around 3 times higher than the maximum is allowed. So we are too fast. We are much too fast to reach this goal. So we have to set a carbon budget. And the implications for the future utilization of oil, gas, and coal are imminent. So we have to desperate nomenclature the words reserves and resources. Resources is the whole, are taken to be the remaining, ultimately recoverable resources on Earth. And reserves are a subset of resources that are defined to be recoverable under current economic conditions and have a specific probability of being produced. So you have resources and you have reserves. And how many reserves we have until 2050? It's not much. Yeah, we'll see at the right picture. These are the resources, and these are the reserves who can be burned between 2011 and 2050 to reach the two degrees Celsius goal. It's not much. And this is the regional distribution of reserves unburnable before 2050. So you can see, for example, in China and India, 66% of the coal resources must be unburnable before 2050. It's much, too much, maybe. So the consequence for us is not the end of fossil reserves could be the motivation for changing our attitude. It must be humanity. It's a difficult word too. So the price for energy will not explode the next 10 or 20 years. Not enough to change our attitudes. So, what's the solution? COP is the climate contract of Paris from the 11th of December, maybe, 2050, with maybe 4, 3, 5 big points. All nations, over 200 nations, signed this contract to limiting global temperature increase well below 2 degrees, better 1.5 degrees, establish binding commitments. That's no binding commitment at the moment. It's only ideas. Commit all countries to report regularly. Yeah, trust. Well, then I have to report. All countries to submit new national documents every five years. You have to send reports to the UN to documentate your support the efforts of developing countries. Big point. And mobilizing $100 billion a year in support by 2020 through 2025 to support developing countries and extend a mechanism to address loss and damage resulting from climate change. Yes? Sea level is rising. So many of the states in the Caribbean region are not more existing anymore if the sea level is rising about one meter. There are no nation anymore, because the ground is only 20, 30 centimeters over the sea level now. So in 20, 30 years, there are 70 centimeters below the sea level. Engaging international emissions trading, call for new mechanisms. But the big points is to limit the increase well below 2 degrees. So is this the solution? Is this the answer? Well, to reach the goal? Only if each chain link collaborate. If one chain link does not collaborate, China, EU, Africa, maybe Asia, USA, then this will not be the solution for the climate changing. So we have lots of problems, lots of things to do. I think the solution is in the cities, in the urban structures, in the smart urban structures, in new power structures, based on an urban urban design, maybe, with sustainable buildings. I don't believe if this is the solution, this contract will be the solution. We will see this year. So, that's my lecture about this theme.